The holy ashrama of Swami Tapovanam was but a small lowly hut constructed with mud and stones. It was roofed with a particular variety of stone slabs commonly available in the Himalayas. This cottage had a very small veranda to its south. On the western wall of the veranda hung a small radiant picture of Lord Mahadeva adorned with serpents. It seemed as though the compassionate Lord Chandrasekhara was pouring his benign grace on all who went there. The floor of the veranda, smoothly wiped with cow dung, as was the tradition then, had hardly enough seating space for four persons together. On its eastern side was spread a small square mat and a seat of sack cloth. We saw on its western side a monk with a radiant face seated on a woolen asana, leaning against the wall facing the east. He was wearing a long ochre robe stretching from neck down to the feet, pink and fair complexioned, with shaven head held high and broad forehead smeared with vibhuti, eyes long and lotus-like, pupils steady and sparkling like the Venus star, nose long and sharp, the calm and majestic face glowing with rigorous penance and strict brahmacharya, long arms stretching down to the knees, slender and tall in physique, our revered Swami Tapovanam was one in whom the qualities of a Mahatma were perfectly synchronized. The very glimpse of that Jivanmukta, who reveled in the solitary realms of inner bliss, was enough to thrill us and make us bow our heads in deep reverence with our palms joined together in fervent salutation. For a moment, my mind became still and filled with supreme ananda. Thereafter, one by one, each of us offered the roses we had at his holy feet and did Sashtanga Pranamas before him. It was with great solace and thrill that we rose up from the floor. Unlike the ordinary sadhus, he neither blessed us with his palm on our heads, nor offered us any vibhuti or fruits as prasad. But we received instead a look of utter compassion and ananda as our prasad. The stamp of that peace and blessing will remain aglow in our hearts throughout our lives. Though he had lost almost all his teeth, he conversed in a clear and beautiful manner, and his diction was superb. His eloquent words, brimming with loving kindness and politeness, couched in small sentences, could attract and please anyone who heard him. He sat there and talked on till 11 o'clock, inquiring about the practice of dharma relating to sannyasins and ashramas that was in vogue in Kerala at that time. He preferred to live unencumbered in the true spirit of a mendicant. He used a kamandalu to keep water and a small bowl of clay to eat his meals. We were overcome with wonder and admiration to see such a severely ascetic way of life being observed by one who was held in great esteem and adored by all. My mind was naturally surprised at seeing the small hut and the rigorous routine of Sri Swami Tapovanam. However, there was in that little Tapovan kuti what I failed to find in any other ashrama, a rare and wondrous shanti.